One mic.
All I need is one mic.
It's just different.
One mic with Big Mike.
The overall tenor of what he's saying is very stupid.
And they say his style is too urban for the radio.
Maybe it's not racism. Maybe it's placism.
Brother has to know his place, right, Bob?
One mic with Big Mike.
Things aren't always what they seem.
A sports talk show, but no subject matter is off limit.
Don't just tell me that the reason something's being done is because that's the way it's always been done. Because the first thing I'm going to say to you is slavery.
And now, your host.
I got the big homie here who needs no introduction.
Big Mike. Mike. Mike.
All I need is one mic.
What up, what up, what up? Welcome back from the weekend. Welcome in to the One Mic with Big Mike show with me, your host, Big Mike. Hope you guys had a good weekend, man. Mine was cool. Got a chance to hang out with my parents for a minute. They came in town Friday. My mom's still here. Long story, but whatever. But yeah, the weekend was cool, man. Got some TV watching on. Didn't really go out, do nothing. You know, I'm a homebody, man. I find myself being a homebody in my elderly state. Once again, it is the One Mic with Big Mike show, being heard every Monday, Wednesday, and Fridays live on Spreaker.com, the Spreaker app, the One Mic with Big Mike.com website, spelled the number one, MICWITHBIGMIKE.com. Also on Blastify.com and on TuneIn.com. If you got the TuneIn app on your mobile devices or your phones or whatever you want to call them, I'm there as well, man. As far as the video situation goes, I'm streaming live video right now, Facebook Live. Go to my Facebook page, facebook.com/onemicwitbigmike. And also, if you guys want to get involved and holler at your boy during the show, feel free to do so via my live interactive chat room. The way you get there is by either listening on Spreaker, the app, or my website. Once again, onemicwithbigmike.com. It's all right here on the screen if you're looking at me on Facebook Live. And then there'll be a little thought bubble, either dancing around or just, you know, stationary. But you'll see it, a little thought bubble icon. Just click on that, and you guys can be a part of the show. You can jump inside the live interactive chat room and do your thing. Now, if you don't get a chance to hang around for the entire show, do not worry. Every show that I do is archived somewhere on the wide world of web, either on Spreaker, either on my website, onemicwithbigmike.com, either on Blastify, TuneIn, iTunes, iHeartRadio, YouTube as well. We're going to start putting up little clips and snippets of the show on SoundCloud as well. So to give you guys some, some what did you miss, or if you missed the One Mic with Big Mike show, here's what you missed type of deal, and then lead you back to one of the outlets that you can hear the show on. It's my... Check and see if my ceiling fan was on. It's warm in this joint, man. Also, make sure you guys are following me on Twitter and Instagram at One Mike with Big Mike, the number one, MICWITHBIGMIKE. Now, I think that's all the business for today. No guests today on today's show, so we'll take a look back with my daily segment on this day at the bottom of the hour, where I give you guys some historical factoids from the world of sports. But on Wednesday, I'm going to double up on Wednesday. So nobody today, but I'm going to go ahead and double up on you on Wednesday at 7:30. The R&B singer, Tank, ladies, you know, a little something for my ladies. He'll be on the show. He's going to be talking about the upcoming New Edition movie. Apparently he has a part in the upcoming New Edition. What is it called? Biography? What is it called when you do a movie about somebody? Anyway. Biopic? What is it called? Anyway, Tank will be in there. And then at 8 o'clock, start getting you guys ready for fantasy football with my guy Matt Latovsky of the Sporting News. He's a fantasy football expert. He's going to join me at 8 o'clock. So back-to-back interviews on Monday. Speaking of the fantasy football, the One Mic with Big Mike Fantasy Football League is popping. I set it up. I'm doing 10 teams. And depending on how fast it fills up, I may do a second league. But right now, all you got to do, send me your email address. You can do so. You can do it in the live interactive chat room right now. Like I said, just click on that little thought bubble you see on your streaming player if you're listening via Spreaker or my website, onemicwithbigmike.com. And send me your email address. either I or Renee Cooper will send you a link where you guys can jump on in and get on the One Mic with Big Mike Fantasy Football League. I'm going to have some giveaways, too. You know, I'm not going to just let it be one of those we do this for fun type of deals. I'm going to make sure I hook some people up. I told y'all a couple of months ago, man, I got, like, some brand new, like, Hawks and Atlanta Braves A-hats that never been worn. You see me on the stream every day. If you're looking at the stream on my Facebook, One Mic with Big Mike, spelled O-N-E-M-I-C-W-I-T-H-B-I-G-M-I-K-E. I wear a different brim every day. You know, my hat game is pretty, you know what I mean? It's pretty steady, you know, but I got a couple of joints that I don't really, I got them. They still in the plastic, never been on anyone's head. So, you know, do some giveaways with that. But like I said, just send me your email address. You can inbox me on Facebook. You can shoot it to me on Twitter. If you want to email them to me, it's mike@onemicwithbigmike.com. Just use the number one. Don't have to spell it out. onemicwithbigmike.com. So on to today's show. I missed a lot, man. You know, my man who I used to produce for, Jason Goff, used to always say, man, you miss a little, you miss a lot. Didn't do a show on Friday. Did the best of on Friday, which I think I need to do because last month, man, you know, shout out to Renee Cooper, man. Last month was a good month this month, still July, but it's a good month for guests. And like I said, it's not over yet, man. We got some things popping off on Wednesday and Friday as well. But no, I didn't do a show on Friday. So like everything seemed like it wanted to pop off, man. Dennis Green, famed coach who I was just talking about on Monday when that Rooney Rule story came out. I'm sitting there talking about him, and then he passed away on what was it, Friday? Maybe I did it. Maybe I spoke. You know, all you people who believe in, you know, there's power in the spoken word. Ridiculous, but whatever. Nah. Dennis Green, man, is out of here. He's one of the guys who I always talk about when we talk about, like, you know, retreading coaches and how black coaches, like, it's almost like you good if you got two. Like, you can get two, maybe. Dennis got the Vikings and the Cardinals. And it was just kind of weird that, you know, like, as soon as the announcement of his death was made, it was like everybody just immediately ran to the Bears or who we thought they were thing. And like, that dude was, like, he was more than that. You know what I mean? I kind of chronicled it. Is that the word I'm trying to use? I kind of mentioned some of the other things that he's done, you know, last week, man, but it was like everybody just wanted to kind of run and do that whole, you know, the Bears are who we thought they were. You want to crown them? And that's cool and fine. I remember seeing that game. I remember my dude that I was with won like $200 off this dude that we didn't even know. He knew that the Bears were going to come back. I was like, you're an idiot. They don't play offense in Chicago. But fumbles and Matt Leinart, they came back and this dude owed him $200 for it. The other thing that happened in the world of the WNBA, man, shout out to them girls, man. You know, I think, if I'm not mistaken, is the WNBA season over with yet? I'm not sure if it's over. I don't keep up with the actual, I don't keep up with the game itself. But, like, shout out to them girls, man, for standing up, man. You know what I mean? And I don't mean in a situation like, and we'll talk about it here. We'll talk about Carmelo, and we'll talk about LeBron and Michael Jordan, all that stuff here coming up. But I don't mean in a situation where it's the popular thing to do. And I don't mean in a situation where it only affects, well, the people who it affects the most. You know what I mean? We'll be the ones to stand up. Like, all them women, man, black and white, you know, we're in a league where it's 70% black, even their, you know, their white sister, and something that I've been calling for in other sports leagues, man. Like, where, you know, the white boys, you know, if something's bad, it's bad. You know what I mean? It ain't just got to be, like, people getting shot for selling CDs is a terrible thing, for selling loose cigarettes. A kid getting shot for playing with a toy gun, that's, you know, that's bad across the board. And if you're going to stand, if you're going to call yourself family and all this kind of stuff, it's my blah, blah, blah team family. You know, your fam is hurting. You know what I'm saying? So shout out to them. But I want to also talk about the subsequent decision to, they were fined by the WNBA. What was it, $500 or $5,000? What was it, $500 or $5,000? It wasn't like one of those, you know, NBA fines, of course, because the ladies don't make as much. The league is not really a money earner, so the ladies don't make as much. But whatever the money was, I think the symbolism of them being fined was it took me back to what to the episode that I did what was it last Wednesday that you know basically saying that it's cool for somebody to stand up if they stand in the lane that you want them to stay in. You know what I mean? And like all that Adam Silver stuff about like, yeah, I support the players and I really want them to go out and express themselves. Yeah, you do. You know what I mean? Until somebody says, my religion doesn't believe in gay marriage. You know, and somebody goes off the beaten path. It's like, wait a minute. We got to find them. Well, it's the same thing. Like, it's something that I'm always talking about fighting. You know, fighting against. Your own hypocrisy and really not going that hard because you really don't mean that. You don't mean people can stand up and say what they want to because a lot of times there are consequences and repercussions that come with those things. In the case of the WNBA, think about what those girls were dealing with. These cats was about to bounce. Like the Minnesota team, the Lynx, they wore some shirts that didn't really have any damn controversy to them. You know, it said, please don't kill black people and also don't kill policemen. But the police who, I mean, when stuff like that happens, they left. They left their post at the Minnesota Lynx game because of the T-shirt. Now, here's the thing. That kind of stuff just feels like you're looking for an excuse to do something. You know what I mean? Like, because nothing said we're against the police. Nothing says the police are doing a terrible job. None of those things were being even intimated. But for whatever reason, their first response was to, you know what? F it. We're going to bounce. And we're going to take our name off the list to be considered any more to work these games, thereby leaving the spectators. Now, of course, it's not no packed house or whatnot. But still, anything could pop off when there's no security there. I just think, man, stuff like that is just such a... It's cowardly, man, and it speaks to the reason why that young man was killed in front of his baby and his woman. Cowardness. You know what I mean? Shout out to my guy, I Am No Doze, Renee Cooper, of course, are in the chat room. He's like, this dude always, you know, come with the, and I don't mind this, by the way. You know what I mean? Because I'm just sitting here talking. I don't have a staff to fact check my stuff. So if I say something that's out of the way, by all means, man, like bring it to my attention because I don't want to be that dude. You know what I mean? Like we're going to talk about some people here and before the show is over who are just way stupid and way, you know, uninformed about things, but still feel the need to speak. So it's $500 to the players and $5,000 to the team. So, you know, in the scale of professional sports, not a lot of money, but the symbolism behind it is way deeper. And like I think I was one of the first people to post that picture of the girls wearing those Pray for Orlando shirts or whatever it was, you know, the Support Orlando T-shirts. And it was like, you can't be that. You can't say like this is a problem. You know, some dude runs up in a gay club and shoots up a bunch of gay people. Yeah, it is. That's a problem. But it's also a problem when the people who are sworn to serve and protect us are just like that dude. You know what I mean? Like, some of them are just like that dude. It can't be that. You know, I guess now the story, after talking to Shane the other day, comedian Shane, like the kid who was just frustrated by his own homosexuality. You know what I mean? Which, you know, obviously opens up another box of things that need to be dealt with as far as the way people are treated. Like, that's my thing to everything, man. Just understand that people are people. Either the bad people or the good people. But all the other stuff, you know, the black, white, gay, Christian, Muslim thing, yeah. You know what I mean? To me, all that stuff serves no purpose but to divide. You know, to put people in these specific little boxes that make it easier to mentally digest. Yeah. They were sending the fines. But I just, and then here's the other thing that happened. this was interesting. A couple of weeks ago, maybe, I mentioned it and just in passing. Lisa Borders is the president of the WNBA, right? Now, in any other league, when we hear fines and we hear discipline, we go commissioner. Well, Adam Silver is a commissioner, but for whatever reason, Lisa Borders was the one that was put front and center on this issue. You know, when it came down to they was wrong and now they trying to be right. That just seemed kind of I don't know. The pessimistic in English side of me just said, you know what? That's some old scapegoat. Like, when she got the job, I think my comment was like, yeah, welcome the new captain of the Titanic. Like, it's something to say that you are the president of the WNBA, but like, to get that job on a business that's a money drain, like I don't know, like, what is she supposed to do? Not as far as the fine stuff goes, because I still in my heart of hearts don't believe that she, a black woman, made the decision to fine these other black women for standing up for the senseless killing of black men. That just don't vibe with me. You know, it really reeks of take one for the team. You new to the party. You know, just got the gig a few months ago. Yeah, let me show you what this is all about. You know, we effed up, and now you gotta be the face of the eff up. Yeah, man, that's, you know, it's tough, man. But hopefully, man, hopefully it's not a situation where we're looking at these ridiculous policemen being able to dictate the actions that are taken towards athletes. Because it happened as well in Cleveland. This kind of just went unnoticed, and it turned out, and everybody wanted to make it a feel-good story, the Isaiah Crowell thing. When Isaiah Crowell reposted that picture that I talked about last week of the police officer kneeling down in front of the guy being his neck being slashed, and then all of a sudden the police started threatening that they wouldn't show up at the Browns game and do security. You know, he apologized. They told him to go to hell or to kiss their ass, one of the two. You know, that your apology don't mean nothing. You need to go pay for these people's funeral and all this kind of stuff. So he ends up like giving a game check and then attending the funeral of these police officers in Dallas. That would have made me even more so look like an a-hole. I'd have been like, hell no, kiss my ass, B. You're not going to extort me. Why? Because I showed a level of an acceptable level of frustration with a system that disregards me at every turn. Come on, B. Whatever. Do what you got to do, man. Like, if you think not showing up and protecting people who ain't got nothing to do with my Instagram post is the answer, once again, that illuminates a bigger problem. If the police feel like their service can be used as a weapon against someone else, come on, man. That ain't cool. It wasn't cool then, it wasn't cool with this WNBA stuff. And I think that may have been the crux of the fine. Like, oh man, we can't just like start letting this run amok because these police officers getting pissed off. Damn them. Seriously. Like, if you work that job and your feelings get hurt that easily, quit. You know what I mean? If you're that fearful of a t-shirt, quit. Because you're the same person that'll be that fearful when you pull me over and I reach for my ID. You're the same dudes. Be done, man. Just go do something else. Work at a factory or something, man. They don't involve that. The other big news today out of I'm going to put everything here up under the NBA umbrella. You dig? This is the One Mike with Big Mike Show. I'm here on Spreaker.com as well as on TuneIn and Blastify and my website, the number one, MICWITHBIGMIKE. You guys can join the show like I Am No Doze and Renee Cooper have via my live interactive chat room. Just click on that thought bubble you see on the streaming player. Now, if you're listening via TuneIn or Blastify, you won't see the streaming player there. You can also, I'll try my best to keep up with the comments on Facebook as well. So if you go to facebook.com/ONEMICWITHBIGMIKE, you can check me out streaming live video for the voyeuristic weirdos, doing my thing on Facebook as well. And I'll try to keep up with your comments there as well while I run my mouth. So the other big news today, Michael Jordan penned a letter to the undefeated voicing, I guess you can say, his frustration about the recent goings on as it pertains to the climate and the relationship between the police and the black community. And it's real funny to me. Let me find Michael Jordan's pieces of it. I'm not going to read the whole letter, but he says, quote, as a proud American, a father who lost his own dad in a senseless act of violence, and a black man, I have been deeply troubled by the deaths of African Americans at the hands of law enforcement and engaged and angered by the cowardly and hateful targeting and killing of police officers. I grieve with the families who have lost loved ones, as I know their pain all too well. Along with him making a statement, which I'll get to all the brouhaha over that here in just a second. He gave up $2 million, went in his pocket and got $2 million, gave $1 million to the Institute of the Community, the Institute for Community Police Relations. This is a brand new organization started in May. It's a law enforcement organization, which, look, I don't know, man. You know, he also gave to the NCAA Legal Defense Fund. Even though it says NCAA, don't be fooled. As of 1957, it's a separate organization from the NAACP. I think Thurgood Marshall is credited with starting or whatnot. Here's the thing, man. There was a lot made today. You know, our mainstream white media was like, oh, kudos. And then a lot of black people were like, you know, Michael Jordan, you know, about time. Carmelo Anthony said, about time. A couple other people was like, you know, that's it. I don't know necessarily where I fall as far as that range of emotion. What I do notice, though, is here recently in society, and I talked about it as related to Carmelo and like the thing that him and LeBron and D-Wade and Chris Paul did at the ESPYs, we've now come to a place where just being a decent human being is breaking news. You know what I mean? Like, we're calling stuff like this taking a stand. Really? Like, don't kill people who don't deserve to die? Like, if a dude is selling loose cigarettes, all right, let him go. You know, I mean, not let him go. I'm sorry. Take him to jail. If it's illegal, take him to jail. If the dude is selling bootleg CDs and some sort of copyright infringement or whatever, all right, whatever. Do that. But to kill him, you know what I mean? Dude's taking a ride with his wife and his old lady and his mama. You know, I mean, mama and his baby. Like, just don't kill him. Like, I don't think that's a bold statement to make. I really, really don't. But when you set the, and I talked about this last week, I do it as a husband. You know, you set the bar kind of low, and then everything you do, you know, that's normal. Like, you know, make the bed. You make the bed. It's like stop the presses. It's like, now it's time for some, you know, reward sex or something. Yeah, it's all good. But in this situation, you know, it's cool. You know, it's cool. And I said this a couple of months ago, when I interviewed a transgender woman named Caitlin Byrne. She's also a sports writer. And we were talking about the HB2 situation in Charlotte, which I'll talk a little bit more about that as the show goes on as well. And the reason we were talking is because Michael Jordan hadn't said anything. And my point, when people would say to me, well, you know, that's Michael Jordan, he don't do that. And I kept making the point that, yeah, that was Michael Jordan when Michael Jordan was an employee and a player and a young black person, right? But now he's an owner. He's a boss. One of the very few that hold that position in any major sport. It's time. Like, now is the time. Like, I can excuse the other stuff. I can write it off to youthful ignorance or stupidity. I could write it off to self-preservation and survival. But now, come on, B, what you got to lose? You know? And I think that's where I kind of fall to the wayside when people start talking about making stands. And because I had to ask the question, like, what do people have to lose? What is anybody losing by saying don't kill black men? You know what I mean? What is any athlete losing? Now, I'm appreciative of it. But, you know, we've kind of fallen into this crazy place where we're kind of, I think, mistakenly viewing that as having power. You know what I mean? Like, I think I was talking to Renee about this. I think me and Renee was talking about this a couple of weeks ago. And there's a lot of things that get said in like black lore and in like just black vernacular, Uncle Tom, you know, when really you're calling someone an Uncle Tom because they don't stand up for themselves or they cower down, but that's not who that man was. You know, history has changed his story some kind of way and turned his name into a derogatory term, but he was killed for standing up for himself. You call somebody a house nigga. Like, we've lost perspective as time is going on. And there are people who say, you know, to see another slave movie, whatever. But no, I look at all of them, even the ones I think are bad. I look at all of them, man, because I think there's still things to learn. I also realize there are people in this world and generations in this world who don't have a perspective on that. They hear black people complaining about it and talking about it, but don't have any idea what it actually is. So sometimes you may need a graphic reminder. They may need a graphic reminder. And the one thing that I looked at, I can't remember. I remember it's that Underground show that I was watching. One of the more powerful characters in that show was one of the house Negroes, the woman. And you saw some of the things she did to just survive and to guarantee some of the survival of her kin. Like, it wasn't a situation where she wanted to be that. She even told one of the field slaves that I envy you, because master can only work you from sun up to sundown. I'm up in here all the time. I'm at his beck and call for anything. For any time he want to come and sexually assault me, any time he want to just vent some frustration, now I'm the one that's here. But we don't look at stuff like that. We look at, oh, Stacey Dash, oh, house. You know, we just throw these things out there. And so to kind of bring it full circle so you don't think I'm just going off on a tangent, I look at Michael Jordan, and I look at his early life. You know what I mean? Like, what if Air Jordan? Remember, he wasn't getting $25 million like LeBron and them is getting now. He wasn't getting Mike Conley money. Yeah, the Nike deal and the Gatorade stuff was cool. You feel me? But the brand wasn't complete yet. So what if that dude did? What if he was a rebel rouser then? You think Michael Jordan would own the Charlotte Hornets now? And sometimes, like me, in you know, getting older and hopefully getting wiser, I look at that and say, you know, maybe not consciously doing it, but maybe that dude was going along to get along. You know what I mean? To put himself in a position to where now he employs more minority upper management than any other sports team. That don't happen if Michael Jordan start going off about kids killing kids, about his shoes and all this kind of stuff. He don't own the Jumpman stuff or the Jordan brand or whatever it is. He's not a billionaire, I don't think. I think all that stops. So now Michael Jordan at 50, yeah, he can do stuff like this. For what it's worth, you know, all day, I guess I assume you guys have heard of all the money and all the things that he has done that wasn't publicized. You know, while, you know, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar famously said he chose commerce over consciousness. Maybe. You know what I mean? But you look at his life and look at Kareem Abdul-Jabbar's life, man. Look at the two, man. You know, like, Kareem ain't had no terrible life, but there's things that he aspired to do, and it's well documented that he wasn't able to do. You know, part of it probably because he's a Muslim. Part of it because he spoke out and he speaks out about a lot of issues. Someone told me a long time ago, man, like, pick your battles, man. When I was a young, hot-headed cat, some wise people told me, man, pick your battles because everyone ain't yours. I still hadn't really, you know, totally grasped the concept yet, but, you know, I'm still kind of a work in progress. It's the One Mic with Big Mike show here on a Monday, back from a long weekend. Shout out to my guy Matt at East Point Maine. He's in the chat room. You guys can join him in there by clicking that little thought bubble you see on the streaming player. If you're listening via my website, onemikewithbigmike.com, or via Spreaker. You can also hear the show live on TuneIn and on blastfy.com. We're going to come back, and I want to wrap this conversation up. I want to talk to you guys about what Dr. Harry Edwards, you guys know Dr. Harry Edwards, he's a professor at USC, the guy with the big gray beard. I want to talk to you about an article I read on some things that he said about the power, that word, power, of today's athlete. And also I want to get into this NBA All-Star situation that I missed out on Friday, of them pulling it out, finally pulling it out of Charlotte. And then, you know, the subsequent, that governor, I mean, that dude is dug in, B. That dude said he ain't going no damn where. So we'll do that next on the Monday edition of the One Mike with Big Mike show.
Dear John, I was hoping it wouldn't come to this, but you've left me no choice. I'm leaving. Uncontrolled high blood pressure is really serious, and lately you seem to really not care. I've been there for you since day one, and I know you think I'm going to keep ticking. But no, my friend, I can quit whenever I want. Why can't we get back to the good times? When we were more active and ate more healthy foods, and you checked on me every once in a while. Is that too much to ask? I don't want to leave, but unless you stop ignoring me, what else am I supposed to do? Remember, when I quit, you quit. Sincerely, your heart.
Listen to your heart and don't let it quit on you. Doing the minimum to control your high blood pressure isn't doing enough. High blood pressure can lead to a stroke, heart attack, or death. Get your blood pressure to a healthy range before it's too late. For help keeping yours at a healthy range, text PRESSURE to 97779. A message from the American Heart Association, the American Stroke Association, and the Ad Council.
You must have thrown 1,000 pitches teaching him to hit a home run. Spent countless Saturdays running routes so he could learn to hit an open receiver. Endless afternoons teaching him how to hit the three-pointer. But how much time have you spent teaching him what not to hit? Teaching boys that all violence against women is wrong is one of the most important things a man can do. Learn how to start the conversation at teachearly.org. Brought to you by Futures Without Violence and the Ad Council.
And now, back to One Mike.
What are we waiting for? Let's get to it.
With Big Mike.
Yeah. Girl, I want to get your body wet. Welcome back to the Monday edition of the One Mike with Big Mike show here on Spreaker.com. I'm here every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday live starting at 7 o'clock. I'm also being heard on TuneIn, BlastFi.com, and my website, OneMikeWithBigMike.com. That is spelled the number one, MICWITHBIGMIKE.com. Also, as I mentioned in the first segment, I got the One Mike with Big Mike Fantasy Football League popping off. You guys want to join that? Just you can inbox me on Facebook, your email address, or if you're listening or you want to jump on in the live interactive chat room real quick and just leave your email address there. Either I or Renee Cooper will send you a link. Just click on that join. You guys can be in the Fantasy Football League. I got my guy from the Sporting News coming up on Wednesday. His name is Matt Latopsky. He'll join me at 8 o'clock to give us some early fantasy football tidbits and techniques and secrets. Also, R&B singer Tank. He's got a part in the upcoming new edition movie. He's going to join us to talk about that and a bunch of other stuff. Let me see what kind of athlete Tank was and where his sports allegiance lie. Before I went to break, let me just make sure I ain't forgetting nothing real quick. Follow me on Twitter and Instagram as well, onemikewithbigmike.com. Before I went to break, I was talking about everything that's going on under the NBA umbrella over the past couple of days with the NBA, with the WNBA players, you know, still making their stand against police violence against black men in America. And, you know, the subsequent flip-flop of the league as far as fining them went. And Michael Jordan today kind of blew people away, sort of, I mean, some people away, by speaking out on the same issue, you know, the gun violence and the violence against the violence being perpetrated against police and by police. And doing my reading today, I ran across this article by Dr. Harry Edwards. See, terrible with names. He was talking about the power of today's athlete, and he was giving some historical perspective as well, you know, during the article. And I just, like, to me, power means the ability, you know, the ability to change things. And in this country, and I could be wrong, of course, but it just feels like the power moves that are being attempted now are the power moves that were attempted then. And the game has changed now. You know what I mean? The game is about people. Like, people are actually being able to make laws. You feel me? That say, if you're this, if you're different than me, I could treat you like crap. Like, this is actually a real, real thing. You got a dude running for vice president. I guess you run for vice president, right? He's on the ticket with Donald Trump. That believes in, what is it? Conversion therapy? When they change you from being a gay dude or a gay woman to a straight one? Yeah. Those are the dudes that's making the rules of this game. So when we start talking about, you know, Carmelo and those boys talking before the ESPYs, okay, cool. You know, I'm not adverse to information at any turn. You know, if it's information, if it's good information, by all means, people need to hear it. And hearing it multiple times doesn't offend me either. But the thing we also got to understand is talking. That's what it is. It's talking. Carmelo had his summit today out in L.A., and I guess he's going to do it in each city that the Olympic team goes in. But still, and yet, what that is just talking. Everything that everyone's talking about is keeping the conversation going. Here's the issue that I have with that concept. The people in charge, they don't care about your damn conversation. They don't. You know, and you say, get out and vote. Well, they've kind of put a chokehold on that situation as well with all the gerrymandering, with repealing the Civil Rights Act and all that kind of stuff. See, the game has kind of been changing little by little, man. And to continue to do the same things, expecting a different result, or even expecting the same result as time passes, we live in a different world than it was in 1965 and 66. We live in a whole new, different world, and the issues are so different and so perverse that I mentioned it last week. I don't know. You know what I mean? I'm stumped, man. You know what I mean? Because I don't know, even right now, if somebody who had a lot of money, if Jay-Z wanted to start buying a politician, the dudes that he's competing with got so much more money than him. I always make this statement to people about what $1 billion is. You know, I don't know if this is changing, but I think the last time I heard, Jay-Z was worth like $300 million, right? It would take three of him plus a third of another him to get to $1 billion. And the dudes that we talking about that's buying and selling these candidates, billionaires, billionaires, multiple times over. So, you know, the moving of the money to the banks and all, like all that stuff, I guess, you know, in some way it helps, but I don't necessarily see me putting all my money in the black bank, keeping a policeman from blowing my damn head off because he feel like it that day, and knowing that he gonna go home after he do it. You know what I mean? He gonna get to go on vacation after he do it. That's the punishment for putting the cap in my ass. So anyway, Dr. Harry Edwards. Well, I was about to call him Harry Carson. Harry Edwards. I'm sorry. This is an article from ESPN. He's quoted as saying that the athletes, quote, have the capabilities today that we only dreamed about in the 1960s when only one or two athletes had endorsements, end quote. Well, here's that's fine that these athletes have endorsements, but how many, like, who you see risking any of those things now? I know Carmelo in his first address to the issue said, you know, we got to stop worrying about that. But in reality, you think Nike going to be like, oh, can't have that. Can't have you saying don't kill black people in this ultra sensitive and ultra, you know, hyperbolic society that we live in, where everything that comes out of somebody's mouth is liable to go viral and initiate a reaction. Nah, hell no. You think how quickly the WNBA was like, nah, okay, we cool. We ain't gonna find y'all. You know why? Because people start tweeting about it and Facebooking about it and all that kind of stuff. Like, that stuff will work on that micro type of level. You know what I mean? Like, if Carmelo came out, like I said something in support of that anti-gay bill in North Carolina. Well, then maybe Nike might be like, oh, we don't support that. Damn that. Mm-mm. Because it goes against, it's outside of the cult of likability. You know, the groupthink. It's outside of that. You know, it's stupid, too. But, like, I'm the type of person that I try my best not to deal in hypocrisy. You know, if I believe that I have a right to believe what I believe in, you do too. If you believe that gay people are going to burn in hell or whatever, you fine. Rock it. You know what I mean? My only issue arises when you feel like the way you believe makes it all right for you to treat somebody like crap. Like, that's like, believe what you want to. I don't care. Like, if you believe I'm a monkey or whatever, fine, dude. Cool. I'm more than cool with that. You know what I'm saying? But just don't get your police brother-in-law to pull me over and kill me in front of my kid. Like let's not do that. Think what you want to about me. Just don't do that. So Dr. Edwards goes on to say, quote, Joe Louis and Jack Johnson and Jesse Owens struggled for legitimacy. Then you begin this struggle for access, which is what Jackie Robinson and Larry Doby and Kenny Washington and all those guys were involved in. In the 1960s, the struggle was for respect and dignity. I would argue that that is the same struggle today. You know what I mean? For even like for athletes, not even just for the regular guy. You know what I mean? Because so many people still have that, you just shut up and play, boy. You shut up and entertain me on Sunday. I don't want to hear your damn view. That policeman, the head of the police in Minnesota said that. He's like, I don't know why the hell these people even just play ball. You shouldn't have a voice in this, is what he said. And he is at the head of the people that are supposed to be fighting crime and protecting and serving and all that. That's the head. I don't know where we go, because the system has become so insulated. And how does somebody get in to change that? You know, there's black mayors and black senators and what, I don't know, maybe black aldermans and whatever, but at what point do they start just, you know, going along? So, like, I want to talk about power, and this what I think is a misconception about what power is. Power in this country has been reduced very simply to economics. Point blank, period. Your economics is your power to change things. While we look around and we look at rappers and athletes, and we're like, damn, they paid. But what did Chris Rock say? Like, Shaq is rich. The dude who writes Shaq's check, he's wealthy. You dig what I'm saying? There's a difference. And when we start talking about like black wealth, what, Oprah? Magic? Maybe? You know what I mean? Because we still, like, I think Oprah got the billions, and I think Mike has been recently, in the last couple of years, been worth a billion, but where else we at? Like, Google it. Look at the Forbes list, man. The American Forbes list, man. And you'll see what I'm saying. Gates, Walmart dude, Buffett. You know what I mean? You got to go, like, down, down, down before you hit, like, Oprah. That's where the change is at, man. You know, the marching and stuff is, you know, cool. You know what I mean? Cool. Harriet goes on to say, now the struggle is a quote. Now the struggle is for power. And these men have power to go to network television and make a statement concerning violence and killing of black men, women and children in this country. That's an exercise of power. I still just think that's influence. I don't think that's power. Nothing changed. Like, what is ESPN going to do? It's the same thing. The same example I just gave with Nike. What are they going to do? Hell no, because the first thing that's going to happen is Carmelo's going to tweet it that I tried to go to ESPN and say I wanted to make a statement to open the ESPYs. They told me no. And it's bad PR for them. So what the hell are they going to say? That's not power. Not power by the athletes. That's fear. That's fear of bad PR from the company. Nah. And because I couldn't do it. Like, I got stuff to say. I couldn't just walk up in the ESPN and be like, you know what? I want to talk about these cops killing black folks. No, I don't have influence. I'm not nobody. But power is not. Nothing changed. There's no power in that. He goes on to say, again, these men have power. And I'm failing to see where it is, man. Talked about Carmelo hosting his meeting in Los Angeles. He talked about it a little bit on ESPN. And like I say, conversation is cool. You know, but you know, like y'all know, if I'm talking to my people, a lot of times you try to have a conversation, what it turn into? Venting sessions. And you walk away like, yeah, everybody got stuff off their chest. But what did we really accomplish? Like, what's the next step? And I think that's where the system has everybody. Where we just lost, man. We're lost not knowing where to turn. It's easy to just cleave to this Black Lives Matter name and try to protect it. It don't need protecting. Whatever, man. If somebody want to holler out, all lives matter. Whatever, dude. Like, if you don't understand, fine. Like I continue to say I don't completely understand. Like I understand what the origin of it was, but now it's morphed into something way more than that. Way more than just like, okay, don't kill black. Like the context has been removed. Because in the original context, it was like, you know, look, police, Black Lives Matter. You know, look, police. But then it began to be attached to everything. You know what I mean? And my reality is very simple. I don't believe that all black lives matter. I don't believe that all black or white lives matter. I don't believe that all lives matter. Like, some people deserve to die. Let's keep it real. Some people do, like, horrible things, and they deserve for their lives to be ended. You know? And not everything's got to be so, like, in where we live now, everything is so cute. I was riding back from the airport, dropping my dad off at the airport. I saw a church. All souls matter. Come on, man. You know? It's like a competition to see who could bastardize it the most. And in reality, you don't need that. It's a very simple concept. You know, just stop. You know, stop fearing everything that's not like you. And that's not just for the police. That's for everybody, man. Stop just having this immediate fear because something's not like you. This reluctancy to become educated about that thing. And act in a negative manner towards it. Like, look, you chose to be a police cuz. That's the real deal. You chose to do that. If you a punk, do something else. You know what I mean? If that's what's real, do something else. If like, if you can't take an ass whooping, do something else. Like, anytime I see a police, like, some dude with, like, his damn belly hanging over his joint, man, and he's like, You could just smell the donuts coming out of his pores. It's like, what the hell are you doing? I automatically assume if you black or you white that you gonna shoot somebody. You ain't in no type of shape to be tussling with no perp. You gonna shoot somebody. Yeah, just be better, man. And I don't mean like the roided out dudes either, because that's another issue with these roided out police that think they freaking John Cena or somebody watching too much WWE. Anyway, let me finish this up real quick. Another quote, he says, if you're out there marching up and down the street with Black Lives Matter and then don't go to the polls to vote out the mayor of Ferguson, to vote out the sheriff of Milwaukee County, or whatever, then you're marching into a cul-de-sac. When you march into a cul-de-sac, you just come back out angry. You're not a member of a movement because it's not going anywhere. You're a member of a mob. And the difference in a representative democracy between a movement and a mob is whether you follow through with the actions necessary to make the changes that you've been trying to convince people are the correct direction to go. I can agree with that. You know, that's why I'm not big on the whole marching thing in 2015, that was last year, 2016. I'm not big on that whole marching thing. You know, I understand, man, people are frustrated and like you don't know what to do. So you do it. So I don't criticize it. I just know I'm not going to have my black ass out there. But what? Everybody just go back to work on Monday. You know what I mean? Or whatever day. You know, it's, I don't know, man. I didn't mean to spend this much time on this, to be honest with you. But as I was just thinking all day after reading this, I was like, that's a misleading concept. You know what I mean? And it disallows people to recognize the actual power structure in this country. It don't come from no damn rappers. It don't come from no damn athletes. You know, these are people who are popular. These are people with influence. These are people who can say, hey, everybody, let's come together and have a conversation, right? But ain't there one of them giving up their lifestyle? Because it would take like that type of movement. Like the pooling of resources by the people who have the abundance of them. And we all know, come on, that ain't happening. I don't foresee it happening. I don't anticipate it happening. And with that being the case, you know, I resigned myself. I said it last week and I'm gonna say it again. I just resigned myself to say, you know what? I just gotta find a way to survive in all this madness and all this chaos. You know what I mean? I gotta find a way to make sure. And there's no guarantee. You know what I mean? People talking like Carmelo was talking about today. He was talking about, you know, teaching the kids at the summit that he held today, you know, how to talk to the police and how to respond to the police. And like every time I hear that, man, it's so much. It's just, I don't want to call it bull, because I know what it's bull that is necessary. That's what I'm trying to say. It's crap that it's necessary. That the game is rigged to the point where the rules ain't even the same for everybody. You know what I mean? And then even when you go about your business properly, you can still get shot in front of your baby. How about that? Welcome to America. It's the One Mike with Big Mike show. We're going to move on here to this NBA All-Star game being moved as well. It's like everything's so heavy in the beginning of the show. Jesus Christ. Some of you probably thought I was going to be talking about the show power. Yep, kind of out the door on that one. I did my two seasons. I did my two-season bid, and then everything just started getting ridiculous with power. Like last year, really, the reason I stayed with it so long last year, because they said Lala was going to show her breasticles, and I was like, well, I can't miss that. I can't like bow out now when Carmelo's lady's going to have her, you know, her chest friends out on TV. Pfft, hell no. And then they were underwhelming. Just, you know, to keep it real, they were underwhelming. So, the whole power ghost and Tommy and Tasha thing, yeah, kind of just, you know what I mean, kind of just exoed that. I canceled the whole Stars situation. Mike Epps got killed on Survivor's Remorse, so I was like, don't really know if I'm going to be back for that. I keep thinking about resubscribing, man, to just see how to survive. I saw the preview with Darius McCrary, I guess, is on there now doing something. I might, man, but... No, but the show, today's show is not about power. It's entitled Power, but it's with a power with two question marks, because we got to talk about, like, what that is, man. Don't forget, the show is being heard on Spreaker, SPREAKER.com, as well as the app. Also on TuneIn, BlastFi, and my website, OneMikeWithBigMike.com, live every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, starting at 7 o'clock. If you don't get a chance to hang out for the entire show, all those outlets will have the show archived, as well as on YouTube, TuneIn, or excuse me, iHeartRadio and iTunes as well. We'll have the show's archived, so you can share it with your friends. You can, you know, do that whole thing there. I do suggest that you do that. And if you're listening right now, also, I'd like for you guys to make sure you click that little heart button you see there as well, so I can get my like situation solid. And don't forget, send me your emails if you want to play some fantasy football with your boy this season. Send me your emails either through my email, mike@onemikewithbigmike.com, or you can do it in the chat room right now. I can always go back and retrieve the emails after the show. I've learned how to do that, retrieve messages after the show. So, while I was gone, Adam Silver, he held true to his threat, promise, whatever you want to call it, and he pulled the All-Star game out of Charlotte behind the reluctancy to remove or to adequately change the HB2 law, the anti-gay law in North Carolina. And a lot of people, and I keep doing this, but because I think people still consider it to be the bathroom bill, and it's not. Like, that in and of itself is ridiculously stupid, but It's not accurate at all. You know, that's part of it. But the other parts of the... Let me find the article where I can actually give it to you guys in full. The quote from Adam Silver goes as such: while we recognize the NBA cannot choose the law in every city, state, and country in which we do business, that's important state, we do not believe we can successfully host our All-Star festivities in Charlotte in the climate created by HB2. They hope to reschedule in 2019 if things are, you know, if things change. But this damn governor, he seemed to be a real jerk off, boy. He's like, whatever, I ain't doing nothing. They went back to, they had like a special session. They tried to make some changes to the bill to kind of appease people, but it didn't work. Adam Silver didn't let the wool be pulled over his eyes. They restored the ability of workers to use state law to sue over employment discrimination, which you should be able to. Like, it's just ridiculously stupid things that they're taking away from people. But they restored it based on race, religion, and other factors, right? So, like, you hear what I'm saying? Black people, if you live in Carolina, if somebody discriminates against you at your job and you find out, before this, they was telling you you couldn't do, you had no legal recourse. So they reinstated it for race, religion, and other factors. Those other factors did not include gender identity and sexual orientation. So you can still be fired from your gig. You can still be passed over for a job if you're gay or you're transgender. Those things can still happen. Like, if you're just a human being, you can't be all right with that. That's crazy. Everybody deserves to earn a damn living. And if you qualified, you know, and when I tell people, like, this is new Jim Crow, this is Jim Crow for LGBT, that's totally different. Really? Really? Talk to your parents and your grandparents. And ask them without putting this into the conversation. Just ask them about that, and then make the comparison. The law passed in a March special session. Same thing. Also excludes sexual orientation and gender identity from anti-discrimination protections related to workplace, hotels, restaurants, and overrules. This is important. Overrules local anti-discrimination ordinances. So if in your town, like in Charlotte, They put forth anti-discrimination ordinances in Charlotte, this state law supersedes that and says, you know what? Screw you being all-inclusive. We want you to be bigots. We're going to make you be bigots. So this governor, Pat McCrory is his name. Here's his statement in the matter. The sports and entertainment elite, Attorney General Roy Cooper, which, by the way, the federal government is suing North Carolina, and the liberal media have for months misrepresented our laws and maligned the people of North Carolina simply because most people believe boys and girls should be able to use school bathrooms, locker rooms, and showers without the opposite sex present, end quote. Now, see, that's, oh, God, I can't stand. Everybody want to do that. They want to use the kids to forward their ridiculous, stupid agendas. You know, what about the kid? I was looking at something the other day about, I think it was a show called, Sex. But they were talking about, like, gay marriage and how people were, in the 70s, this one lady, like, that was her platform. We can't have these people teaching our kids that being gay is right. And they, like, caught fire. And it became a thing. And then people started passing similar laws way back then. It's so crazy, man. Just, like, if you zoom out a little bit, just how cyclical things are, man. And these people are going to lose millions of dollars, man, that could have been made. This is not like FIFA bringing in this soccer or the Olympics. Like, all your infrastructure is there. You don't really have to do nothing as a city. Put up some signs, you know, have some events. You know, people get to sell their T-shirts and their water and all this kind of craziness. It's a win, man, for the people. But their governor is so dug in on his ridiculous stance. That he's going to deny those people of that. Now, I remember talking a couple of months ago to Wade Davis. He's a gay guy who played in the NFL. And I talked to him about the same situation that happened here. You know, even the same situation that happened with the WNBA and the fines being rescinded. It's like, how much of a win is it really? You know what I mean? Like, kind of, but no one's changing. I don't think Sonny, what's the governor's name here? Nathan Deal, or none of them folks change the way they feel about this thing. They just ain't want to lose that money. Now it's happening. The thing that I asked him about, like, what happens when some dude just don't give a damn about no damn money? He's just dug in on his quote unquote principles, like the wacko in Kentucky who ain't want to marry these gay dudes, like her. You know, like, I don't care. I'm going to do it because it's my religion and all this foolishness. I don't know. Like, I don't even think that the NBA should have given them a damn out and saying 2019 we might come back. Nah, screw you. Just do the right thing. Treat people like human beings. How about that? It's the One Mic with Big Mike Show, man. It's the end of hour number one. I'm going to take a quick break here. Catch my breath, man. We're going to come back. We're going to come back and have some fun. We're going to get like mad silly with something that happened with one NFL player. And I totally resist most times being like, I do so damn stupid. Yeah, this dude is hella stupid. And wait till you hear who and what I'm talking about. I do it next on the One Mic with Big Mike Show. Here heard on Spreaker.com, the app, as well as my website, onemicwithbigmike.com, and blastfy.com, and tune in as well. I'm live every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. Make sure you guys join the conversation. You can do so via the live interactive chat room. Just go to either Spreaker or TuneIn, or not TuneIn, sorry, Spreaker or my website, onemicwithbigmike.com. Click on that little thought bubble. It'll take you to the live interactive chat room. You guys can get on some of this hour number two stupidity. I'll be right back.
Attention men, under the age of 35. You know what really impresses the ladies? When a guy has a few drinks and later gets pulled over for buzz driving. That could cost you around $10,000 in fines, legal fees, and increased insurance rates. There goes let's grab dinner and a movie. Oh, I know. You drive more carefully when you're buzzed. You've proven that hundreds of times. A woman admires that kind of confidence. And you've practiced how to speak if a cop does pull you over. Slowly, clearly, and politely, like, good evening, officer. A woman admires that kind of foresight. And what woman doesn't find it adorable that you call it buzzed even though the law calls it drunk? You could kiss $10,000 goodbye, along with any chance of having a girlfriend. Because nothing says, I'm a catch, more than a guy who lives in his parents' basement and calls it my place.
Buzzed, busted, and broke. Because buzz driving is drunk driving. A message from the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
When is the best time to talk to your family about staying in touch during a disaster? When floodwaters reach your door? When wildfires are engulfing the edge of your neighborhood? Or an earthquake is destroying buildings? When a tornado is tearing through town? Or a hurricane strikes? Or is the best time, perhaps, today? During a disaster, you may not be able to stay in touch with your family or friends as easily as you think. And it's not always as simple as using your cell phone. That's why now is the time to take action. Go to ready.gov/communicate and make your emergency plan today. Don't wait. Communicate. Brought to you by FEMA and the Ad Council.
One mic.
All I need is one mic.
It's just different.
One mic with Big Mike.
The overall tenor of what he's saying is very stupid.
And they say his style is too urban for the radio.
Maybe it's not racism. Maybe it's placism.
Brother has to know his place, right, Bob?
One mic with Big Mike.
Things aren't always what they seem.
A sports talk show. But no subject matter is off limit.
Don't just tell me that the reason something's being done is because that's the way it's always been done. Because the first thing I'm going to say to you is slavery.
And now, your host.
I got the big homie here who needs no introduction.
Big Mike. Mike.
All I need is one mic.
All right. Had to turn the damn mic on. What up, man? Welcome back to hour number two of the One Mic with Big Mike Show. I've been calling this on social media the best kept secret in sports talk. I want to change that, though. I want to make sure everyone gets the chance to figure out or check out what I'm doing here. I feel like what I'm doing is different. You know what I mean? I feel like it's something that you're not going to get everywhere. You're not going to turn on Dan Patrick and hear this, or Colin Cowherd, or even guys like Bomani, who's like, I love Bomani stuff. I heard his show once, his radio show once. It sounded different than what I expected it to sound like, to be honest with you. But of course, he got an employee to worry about, and that's, I ain't never trying to take no check out of nobody's pocket. You understand? Don't forget, I'm being heard every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday here on Spreaker.com, Spreaker. Make sure you guys download the app as well. And follow me on Spreaker. Sign up for your free Spreaker account And give your boy a follow, One Mike with Big Mike. Also, I'm live on TuneIn, Blast, Fire, and my website, onemikewithbigmike.com. After the show, all episodes are archived on those four outlets, as well as on YouTube, iHeartRadio, iTunes as well. See, my sign is halfway covered up. I'm that big of an idiot. Also, I'm forgetting to mention this, my sound offline. You guys can sound off, especially coming up on Wednesday. Since coming up on Wednesday, I got my fantasy football guy joining the show, Matt Latowski of Sporting News. You guys can send your early fantasy football questions to my sound offline at 678-568-9011. Just call that number. Let it ring a couple times. Then the answering service will come on. Then you record your message. Keep it to 30 seconds or less for me. You know what I mean? Be concise. Ask your question, and I'll play it back for Matt, and he'll hopefully have an answer for you. This is my first time using him, but most of the time, man, I find out these fantasy dudes are like plugged in, dude. They're like weirdos, like in a good way. You know, like I talk about people being like soccer weirdos and things like that, but not weirdo in a bad way. They're weirdo in the way of like hella, like almost too knowledgeable, if that's the thing. Yeah, these dudes are like plugged in. Started off the show talking about couple things, talking about some things that I missed over the weekend since I took Friday off. The WNBA fining their players for wearing black t-shirts in support of the Black Lives Matter movement, and the subsequent fallout from that, and then they came back and rescinded those fines. I talked about Michael Jordan today speaking out for one of the first time. Why did I say it like that? See, I'm doing the same thing, like acting like it's a big deal when it really shouldn't be. You know what I mean? I heard that in my headphones, like, who the hell was that? That was me. Michael Jordan saying that, you know, police shouldn't kill black people, and consequently black people shouldn't go out and kill police in revenge. I mean, something that should fall under that topic of common sense, but for whatever reason, it hasn't been here lately. It really hasn't. I saw that there was a mass shooting. We call it a mass shooting. 17 people injured, I think 2 dead, right outside of Tampa at a teen night at a club. I don't know the details of it. I just know what I just told you guys. So, you know, systematically, there's a huge issue in this country, man, where, like, slowly but surely, it's come to the place where I'm just going to shoot you. You know, if I'm mad about, no matter what I'm mad about, I'm going to shoot somebody. Not even the person that you're mad at. Like, damn. You just go out and just shoot random people. But, you know, we can have that conversation another time. And I also talked about the NBA pulling the All-Star game out of the city of Charlotte and the state of North Carolina, to be more specific and more precise. Let's move on to the land of the National Football League. I don't know, we're like 40-something days away from the NFL season officially starting. Camp is opening up. Teams are reporting to camp sporadically here over the next week or so. So it's time, man. It's time to really, you know, to rock and roll and get things started, man. Fantasy football, all those things, man. But the NFL is holding steady, man. You know what I mean? Holding steady to their position on marijuana, cannabis, weed, the sticky icky, the chronic, whatever you want to call it, right? That perp. They're holding steady to their ridiculous, antiquated, archaic position on this plant. You know what I mean? And, you know, some suspensions. Oh, Le'Veon Bell, it was reported last week that he was facing a 4-game suspension. You know, he missed 2 games last year. He appealed it. He was hanging out with LeGarrette Blount. That's true. And they got pinched for some weed, and then he got suspended for a couple of days, if I can get my conversion out. Got suspended for a couple of games. It was supposed to be 4. He got it reduced to 2 last year. And as we know, he ended up getting hurt, you know, as the season progressed. Well, he's reportedly by ESPN to be facing another suspension, this time for not taking the drug test. And different reports have come out about how he may have missed a few drug tests. He came out and he assured people that he won't miss any time. I don't know how he's supposed to pull that off. The only thing I think he's banking on the fact that Roger Goodell is not the person ruling on this. With matters of the substance abuse policy and PEDs, they go to a third party arbitrator. Here's the other thing I found interesting today. The fact that we shouldn't even know about this. You know what I mean? Like, the NFL Network is putting this out, and they're confirming this stuff, but the NFL Network is a part of the NFL. It's a subsidiary of the NFL. The NFL policy on these things is that no information should be out about a player being suspended until the player is actually suspended. You know, so for them to come back and confirm the reports with the NFL, they're violating their own policy. You know what I mean? To say you suspect it is one thing, but to not have it confirmed by the league, that ain't cool. Because the reality is, these things apparently happen all the time. Dudes are facing suspensions. They appeal them. The appeal goes through, and they're never suspended, and we never hear about them. But, you know, I guess, man, in the day and age, in today's day and age, it's hard to hide anything. But just so that you know, there are some, like, players union stuff involved in this as well. The fact that it has been so publicized. But either way, my man said he ain't gonna miss no games. We'll see. A cat who's missed a bunch of games. Two cats, as a matter of fact. Well, one who's done. Well, not done yet. He got four more. Josh Gordon was reinstated today, the wide receiver for the Cleveland Browns. Here's how he's been described all day. The often troubled. Is the dude on meth? What am I missing here? You know, like, remember early on Chris Carter talking about he got a dependency problem. Chris Carter, who, by the way, was on coke when he played for the Eagles. Like, do you even understand the difference between coke and weed? Like, and I'm gonna say this to you right now. If his piss wasn't dirty, you wouldn't know that dude was on anything. Like, Lawrence Taylor was on crack. You know, maybe in retrospect, you look at that and be like, because the stories have come out that Bill Parcells knew and all this kind of stuff. And maybe not in retrospect, you look and say, yeah, I can tell that dude was on. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But nah, that kid Josh Gordon, well, maybe because it is weed. But you know, who among you have heard that dude utter more than two sentences in his playing career? Like, that ain't that dude. You know what I mean? Like, he talked a little bit when he came back from the first suspension, and he was like, yeah, I'm ready to prove myself and get back out there with my teammates, and you know, blah, 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 blah. But this ain't that dude. He ain't on nobody's commercials and all that kind of stuff. He ain't on the field acting a fool. But they want to call him often troubled. Why? Because he's falling subject to a stupid rule in a stupid league where a lot of people are getting it on. Speaking of stupid, and I mentioned this before I went to break, I'm very reluctant to when things like this happen. Like, people go to that bag way too early for me. Sometimes, like, a dude gets popped for smoking weed. Oh, man, he's so damn stupid. Why? Because he make a lot of money, but he still like to smoke weed? Why does that make him stupid, though? But in the land of stupid stupidity, there is one Alden Smith. He's now a Raider. He was a 49er. He's been in some legal stuff too, you know, yelling out bomb or something like that at the airport, and he has some other issues. And he's on this latest suspension. I don't even know what this latest suspension is for. I think it's for substance abuse. That is far beyond the point. Apparently, this dude has a what is it called? Not Snapchat. It's the other one, Periscope account, right? And it's under like a pseudonym. It's not even under his name. But, you know, from his previous post, you know he's in them. You know it's him. You know who it is. You know, like, here's a story. He's using an account titled Revenga to post video segments under the name Ricky. The account, as of Sunday morning, had 29 followers. Smith is clearly shown in camera in most videos where he generally talks about current events and what he's doing at the moment. Among the 31 video segments archived and publicly available is an installment entitled Fire Up Session, where Smith never appears on camera, but his voice is unmistakable when compared to the other videos when he talks directly to the camera. Has a conversation with an unidentified female about a hand-rolled cigarette shown on screen. You want to hit? Here go.
Yeah, I'm not f***ing with you.
Ain't nobody else.
We got zero followers. Why is the ashtray up? This is what you call a fire up session.
You shouldn't even be posting that.
He shouldn't.
Do you see my face? They don't have my name. This is just a fire up session.
Yeah, it is.
So it is. Just put it on there. It's just doing it. It's live. Oh, that's hella stupid.
It is stupid.
Shut up. You hella stupid. You trying to smoke, fam? Is this Astra?
Yeah. You ain't using them no more, right? Oh, this is a fucking weed jar? Oh, no, a weed jar.
Let me get out of this shit. You're stupid. You're tripping.
Watch this.
Yeah, they don't know it's me. It's not like I put Alden Smith.
At the end, he says, they don't know it's me. It's not like I put, this is Alden Smith. Dude, oh, God. Like, that is so outstandingly stupid. Like, some of you are going to feign and act like you care. Like, oh, man, how can that dude do? I don't care. Like, look, his situation can't be more important to me than it is to him. Like, I just appreciate the dude adding some comedic levity to this show that started off so heavy, man. That dude is on camera, right? Thinking he's anonymous, because that's what the internet is, smoking a blunt and telling the girl that's telling him, you're stupid for doing this, you shouldn't do this, you need to worry about your career, blase, blah, blah, blah. You're stupid. It ain't like I'm telling them that it's me. I ain't saying it's Alden Smith. Then, look, like, in true ridiculous, stupid dude fashion, he comes back with, a Twitter post that says, nice try. Not nice try, not me, or something like that. Yeah, come on, B. They about to ban your black ass from the entire league forever on some dumb stuff. Like, it's one thing to fail a test, right? That's one thing. But it's another thing, dude. Like, this ain't Laramie Tunsil from some years ago, dumb kid, you know, doing this thing. You already in trouble, kid. You not playing now because of suspension. And that's the move? Yeah. I'm good. Like, whatever, man. Like, the ridiculously stupid nature of this is just perfect. I don't think it could get any better. The only way it could get any better is if, like, the girl was wearing some mirrored aviators and you could see him in her glasses. That's the only thing that would make it more perfect. Good for him, man. Do your thing, man. What did they say? YOLO. Yeah, dude. Get it on, man. Get your thing on, man, and say goodbye to football, my man. You know, the Raiders going to be all right. They got a kid named Khalil Mack. Pretty damn good. They got another kid named Bruce Irvin, who's shown some promise in the NFL. They gonna be all right without Alden Smith. Like, I'm not that, like, dude be trying to act like these dudes be on weed and it's crack. It's not crack. It's not even close. The government has told you that they've made it a Schedule 1 drug, which means no federal funding can go towards researching the plant. You know what I mean? This is why guys like Eugene Monroe, it's like the NFL. If the NFL is concerned about concussions, which I got a story about the NFL's new concussion policy, which, God, they're going to die with that lie, boy. Their new concussion policy. This is why Eugene Monroe is like, the NFL need to step up and fund some of these studies on cannabis, because the Fed can't do it. You know what I mean? The government can't do it because of where the plant has been scheduled, which, by the way, the government has a patent out on the medicinal properties of marijuana. So if you're looking for ideal hypocrisy, there it is right there. You know, yeah, this drug is worse than crack and meth, but we're gonna take out this patent on the medicinal properties of it. That's your government, man. That's where we live, man. That encapsulates everything that's wrong with this place and this country, man. The enormous levels of accepted hypocrisy. You know what I mean? The idiocy doesn't stop either. I just talked about former tackle Eugene Monroe. Now, another former D-tackle, Anthony McFarlane. He lets people call him Booger on TV. like the kid from Revenge of the Nerd. He lets other grown men, like, that's cool if you you're a player, you dig, like, that's your nickname as a player, and you like this fat sloppy dude. But yeah, dude, stop letting these white people call you booger, cause your name is Anthony. It's like, you don't do it. That's not like me. Like, people have gotten on me about that before, like not using my last name, just going by Big Mike. Well, you know, that's kind of different, and it's descriptive as well. Booger is something that's gross and disgusting to any rational human being, you know, and like, I don't care if it has any type of sentimental means. You're on ESPN every day, you know, like get your act together. But anyway, he's on Mike and Mike last week, right? And they're asking him about an interview that Randy Moss did with Peter King's website, The Monday Morning Quarterback. And they asked Randy Moss about, of course, about weed in the NFL. And paraphrasing, he said the NFL need to get off people and just let these players live, man. Let them live their life. So they asked Anthony Booger about it. Bear with me now. This is a little bit long. It's about 90 seconds long. But it's full of stupidity and idiocy. So enjoy.
Here's the thing, Greeny. This is a league that has a reputation and it stands for something in an era where they're trying to clean the game up from a safety perspective. In an era where sponsors are starting to spend more money marketing this league, the players are making more money, there has to be some responsibility from the players and some rules to go by. I would venture to say that probably 50% of the league right now is smoking marijuana.
It's probably more.
If I want to base it off when I played, I would probably say it's around 50%. Doesn't mean it's right. Some of those guys just know when the tests are coming. Some of those guys just know how to pass drug tests. Some of those guys are just getting lucky, and some of them are not, which is why you're seeing more and more substance abuse suspensions in this league. You have to stand for something if you're the NFL. I love the steroid policy. I love the drug policy.
She's
if
an
you
idiot.
Can't be clean, making the amount of money that the players are making now, then you're basically saying, you know what? I'll choose a temporary high or a temporary good feeling over a lifetime of riches.
Now watch this.
I was part in this league for 9 years. Okay, never took any steroids, never even smoked marijuana, barely had a drink in my life on my wedding night and ring night for my two Super Bowl rings. But other than that, straight clean. You can play this game at a high level doing things the right way. And for the players that talk about, well, let's use it for pain management.
This.
Yeah, that's baloney. There may be some medicinal use. I'm not a doctor. There may be some. From an NFL player perspective, though, there are enough drugs in the NFL that if you're in pain, they can help you without smoking marijuana. And to
Wait,
me,
what?
They're using it as an excuse to do a drug that gets them a temporary high and makes them feel good, so to speak.
Now, you can stop counting the ignorant and stupid things that Booger said in that clip. You can stop counting. You know, you probably ran out of fingers. You know what I mean? Like, anytime you want to say anything to me, like if you're making a stand on something, don't go in telling me what you're not. Like, when you're commenting on the benefits, the medical benefits of something, and then you say to me, I'm not a doctor, well, then shut the hell up then. If you're already disqualifying yourself, why should I listen to anything else you're saying about it? Why? Because you didn't smoke marijuana? Like one of the more heartbreaking things that I've ever heard doing this show. When I was talking to former Broncos and Browns running back Ruben Drones, and I was like, man, you know, we're talking about he uses cannabis, you know, instead of using, you know, oxycodone and Vicodin and these opiates, right? And I asked him, I was like, look, man, like what are you most scared of? That dude said, I'm most scared of turning 40. Like, he's the same age as I am. I'll be 40 next year. Like, I have certain fears on becoming 40 because you got to get certain tests done that involved finger insertion to your rectum, which I'm not, you know, happy with at all. But his fear is different. Like, he's like dudes is killing themselves after the age of 40, man. And he's telling me that he already feels the symptoms of the constant pounding that his head took playing NFL football. So when somebody, again, back to that whole, you know, this is your brother and all this stuff, when somebody comes in and just minimizes it, like these dudes are making excuses, and you know they can take the drugs that the NFL gives them, because of course he don't even know that there's a lawsuit against the NFL for dudes who, after they're done playing, are still hooked on these drugs and turn to things like heroin. Because if you don't know, they're the same thing. Oxycodone, Oxycontin, Yeah, they're in the same family as heroin. And people are quick to, when people need what they need or want what they need or whatever, want what they want, they come to figure that out very quickly. It's the same thing. And they go start scoring heroin and stuff. So for this dude to say, for him to prop up pill popping and dismiss, you got to stand for something. Are you out of your rabbit ass mind? This is why, man, this is one of the things that just really, the part that you didn't hear that I cut out of the clip was the part where Mike Greenberg says, really? When he says, these dudes are making an excuse. Mike says, oh, really? Because this is a dude who's read. There's plenty of research out there. Guys like Jake Plummer, you know, are big time advocates of this, man. Of not saying go out and get high all the time, but saying, you know what? This plant has been shown to have some amazing effects on people, not just athletes, cancer patients, AIDS patients, people who are what do they call wasting? You know, they're wasting because of the disease. It helps them out. And he's saying that, and then there's also research linked to head trauma in reversing the effects of head trauma, which is something that the NFL says they're all about, you know, protecting the head and all this kind of stuff. But everybody want to make stupid, like I said earlier, these stupid excuses. What about the kids? Well, what about them? There are things that are for adults. Liquor, cigarettes, that aren't illegal and kill way more people. This ain't me making this up. Like, there's certain things that I know, and this is one of them. These things kill way more people than marijuana ever has, ever. You know what I mean? So what do you think is going to happen? Who's going to show up on the field high? These dudes are professional athletes. The same way that some dude who likes to get drunk don't come to the game drunk. Not that we know of. I've never heard of it. I heard Johnny Manziel showing up at practice hungover. You know, but he's an idiot. You know, and he had no business on nobody's NFL team the way things have panned out. But the dudes who we watch on Sunday, the Richard Shermans of the world, the Drew Breeses and the Cam Newtons, these dudes that understand, man, that this is what they do. Ain't nobody ever accused Josh Gordon of doing nothing but catching touchdowns and racking up yards on the field. So if he leave and go spark one up, what are we talking about, man? Like, really, I keep saying this, and I'll continue to say it. We're going to look at this marijuana issue in the NFL in 10 years the same way we look at head injuries now. You know, like, I can't believe they let that stuff go on. We're going to be looking at it. I can't believe dudes got suspended for that. You know, once people get off the ass and start putting their money towards the research of these medicines, and people start actually understanding that the thing that you're fighting so hard against. And when I come back in the last segment of the show, I'm going to talk about the NFL's new policy, concussion protocol policy. But it's also stupid. You know what I mean? It's so stupid, man. Like, it's like washing windows. It's like doing construction on the Georgia Dome. You know, a guy fell off the Georgia Dome when they were first constructing it and died. There's certain inherent risks that come with what you do, being a jump instructor for parachuters. You know what I mean? There's certain inherent risks that just come with these things, man. And football is one of them. There's no way around that. That football has an inherent risk to it that you can't go through a, you know, 10, 12-year career banging your head against somebody and just, you know, and expect it to have no effect on you. And maybe it won't. But to, like, I'm gonna be straight when it's over with. Nah, ask Jim McMahon. I remember sitting across from Don Mikowski talking about all the stuff that's going on with him. Again, Ruben Jones, dudes like that, man. My man Terrell Troop. I'm gonna say Terrell Pryor. He's not my guy. Terrell Troop, you know, back surgery after back surgery after back surgery. Like, it's real. This is real stuff. As well, I'm gonna talk about this situation. What did I say earlier, or just a few minutes ago, about the NFL concussion thing? And I also want to talk about one of my least favorite people in the world of college football, Dabo Sweeney. He was on. He was all over ESPN today, and I caught him earlier on College Football Live. Again, man, this show is like full of idiocy, man. And when we talk about like power, the people in power are sometimes the biggest idiots. You know what I mean? So we'll talk about all that before we get up out of here. I want to talk about this Chris Sale situation, baseball, one of the best pitchers in baseball. Oh, you know what I didn't do today? I didn't do on this day. I do on this day when I get back as well. Jesus, what the hell is wrong with me? I missed one day and I act like I'm doing the show for the first time in ever. Golly, I'm a turd bag for that one, B. Anyway, this is the One Mic with Big Mike show heard on Spreaker and the app. Every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, I'm also heard live on TuneIn and Blast5.com as well. If you missed the show, if you missed the beginning of the show, if you have to miss the rest of the show, feel free to come back and share it with your friends as well. You can do so via those four mediums as well as YouTube, iTunes, and iHeartRadio as well. Don't forget to sound off. Send your fantasy football questions, your early fantasy football questions to me at 678-568-9011. Keep them to 30 seconds or less if you don't mind, and I'll let my guy Matt Latovsky, if I'm saying that right, Matt Latovsky of the Sporting News, answer your questions for you when he comes on to the show at 8 o'clock on Wednesday. I'll be right back.
Dear John, I was hoping it wouldn't come to this, but you've left me no choice. I'm leaving. Uncontrolled high blood pressure is really serious, and lately you seem to really not care. I've been there for you since day one, and I know you think I'm going to keep ticking. But no, my friend, I can quit whenever I want. Why can't we get back to the good times? When we were more active and ate more healthy foods, and you checked on me every once in a while. Is that too much to ask? I don't want to leave, but unless you stop ignoring me, what else am I supposed to do? Remember, when I quit, you quit. Sincerely, your heart.
Listen to your heart and don't let it quit on you. Doing the minimum to control your high blood pressure isn't doing enough. High blood pressure can lead to a stroke, heart attack, or death. Get your blood pressure to a healthy range before it's too late. For help keeping yours at a healthy range, text PRESSURE to 97779. A message from the American Heart Association, the American Stroke Association, and the Ad Council.
When is the best time to talk to your family about staying in touch during a disaster? When floodwaters reach your door? When wildfires are engulfing the edge of your neighborhood? Or an earthquake is destroying buildings. When a tornado is tearing through town, or a hurricane strikes, or is the best time perhaps today? During a disaster, you may not be able to stay in touch with your family or friends as easily as you think. And it's not always as simple as using your cell phone. That's why now is the time to take action. Go to ready.gov/communicate and make your emergency plan today. Don't wait. Communicate. Brought to you by FEMA and the Ad Council.
And now back to One Mic with Big Mike.
And here we go!
Welcome back to the Monday edition of the One Mic with Big Mike show here on Spreaker.com, the app, BlastFi, TuneIn, the website, OneMicWithBigMike.com. There's some, you know what, I need to start writing more stuff now. Like, I got, like, these reminders posted around my studio that y'all can't see. If you or anyone you know would like to partner with the show as far as being an advertiser, you can do so via emailing me. Email me at Mike@onemicwithbigmike.com. Either I or Renee Cooper will get back to you and try to set something up for you. Again, if you or anyone you know has a company and would like to partner with me as far as being a sponsor of a segment, if you want to sponsor on this day, if you want to sponsor a segment of the show, if you want to sponsor an hour, if you want to be the title sponsor of the show, all those things are available, man. You guys can email once again, Mike@onemicwithbigmike.com. The number one, MICWITHBIGMIKE.com. Speaking of on this day, almost forgot to do it today. Let's do it right now.
Now, let's take a look back.
Day. On this day. All right, let's get through it. On this day in 1952, CBC, Radio Canada TV covers a Montreal Royals baseball game, the first experimental Canadian telecast. I'm actually watching Canadian football right now on ESPN2, the CFL. My homeboy used to coach up there in Saskatchewan. On this day in 1978, the Cincinnati Reds' Pete Rose sets the National League record by hitting in 38 consecutive games. On this day in 1990, if you're old enough to remember this, Roseanne Barr, she sings the national anthem at the San Diego Padres game, and when it was over with, she grabbed her crotch and she spat, and everybody booed because apparently she disgraced the national anthem by doing what baseball players do all the time. And then she was a fat woman, so that made it even more deplorable, I guess. Whatever. On this day in 1999, Lance Armstrong, everybody's favorite one-testicle bike rider, he wins his first Tour de France, the very first one. And then subsequently on this day in 2004, he won his record 6th consecutive Tour de France. I don't know how many he did with only one ball and juiced up on roids. I think he probably did all of them juiced up on roids, but I don't know how many he did with one ball. And I think he ended up with 7 in total, if I'm not mistaken. Or had 7 before they stripped his ass and discovered one ball. No, I'm just playing. That is your Monday edition of On This Day. An hour late, but still on time. Ain't that what the church folks say? He didn't come when he wanted to, but he's always on time. It makes no sense, like plenty of other church stuff, but whatever. Okay, so the NFL. Right before I got on there today, they introduced a brand new concussion policy. This is getting so weird, man. Just let these grown men go out there and just pulverize each other. Let it happen, man. Whatever. Like, at this point, there's no, you know, excuse of not knowing. But anyway, so it's not just the NFL. The Players Association as well kind of got together. I think this is kind of in the answer to what happened to, what was it, Blaine Gabbert last year? Remember Blaine Gabbert was out there on the field? I think it was against the Falcons, too. Like, he was almost murdered on the football field, and he just kept on playing like nothing was wrong. And then Colin Kaepernick got in there for a couple snaps, and then he came right back. Maybe it wasn't him. Who was it? Was it Sam Bradford? It was one of those bum-ass quarterbacks, man. And almost got destroyed and was out on the field drunk as hell. Or was it the kid from the Steelers, the backup for the Steelers? I don't remember, but you guys know what I'm talking about. Anyway, so in this new policy, a first violation will require the club employees or medical team members involved to attend remedial education and or result in a maximum fine of $150,000 against the club. The second and subsequent violations of the concussion protocol will result in a minimum of $100,000 fine against the club. In the event that the parties agree that a violation involved aggravating circumstances, whatever that means, the club shall be subject in the first instance to a fine no less than $50,000. The commissioner shall determine appropriate discipline for the subsequent violations involving aggravating circumstances. In the event that the commissioner determines that the club's medical team failed to follow the protocol due to competitive considerations, meaning like if you're about to go on a game-winning drive and your quarterback gets banged in the head, got to pull him out and lose the game with your backup quarterback. The commissioner may require the club to forfeit draft picks, and impose additional fines exceeding those amounts set forth above, which gives him the right to just fine your ass whatever he wants to. Now, the NFL and the NFLPA will have one representative each to investigate possible violations and monitor the policy's implementation. Representatives involved in the violations investigations won't make medical judgments. They will simply determine whether the protocol was followed. Once investigations are finished, the NFL and NFLPA will decide whether a violation was committed. A third party arbiter will intervene if the two sides can't agree and then issue a report to Goodell, NFLPA Executive Director DeMar Smith, and the other relevant parties. Now, here's the thing. Players know this. And, like, I've seen it before. I've seen, like, one of those white kids from the Patriots, either Edelman or the other kid, Amendola, like, get rocked, just get blasted, and knew that people was going to be checking him for a damn concussion. So he gets up, like, flexing his elbow. Like, nah, B, you ain't get hit there. We all saw it. So now this is probably what you're going to force players to do even more so. You know, guy gets hurt, game-winning drive, you know, the game's on the line. Like, the NFL, 16 games, man. I know, newsflash, but, you know, so they count. You know what I mean? And to lose one that you got an opportunity to win at the end because, you know, you got a little dinged up. The NFL, just like I said before, they're going to die with this lie, man. They're just going to continue to be stupid, man, and not just say, like, look, all right, we lied. We lied to people, told them it was safe to continue to get hit in the head and nothing would happen to them, and now things have kind of gone topsy-turvy. Nope. You know, and I think the settlement is done. Like, well, I think they got some other things to deal with like wives of players or wives of deceased players and things of that nature. So maybe after all that's done and everybody gets their money and the NFL spent whatever they're going to spend, they come out and be like, all right, here's the real deal. I doubt it, but whatever. Let me see. We got like 20 minutes, so I'm going to go ahead and get to everything else here. College football, you know, is about to start as well. A week before, of course, the NFL. And so all these coaches are running their ass through ESPN. They call it the car wash or whatever. So today, I saw Dabo Swinney, Clemson coach, you know, last year's runner-up. That dude is a piece of work. They asked him the question that, you know, he hasn't known what's coming, but he's put himself in such a stupid predicament as it relates to paying athletes, right? The ACC, I mentioned it last week, the ACC has just signed a brand new deal with ESPN for them to have an ACC network here in the next, I think, 2 years. I think next year they're just doing digital, the streaming and things of that nature. And then the year following, they'll move it to like where the SEC network is, where they actually have a channel and hosts and all these things, right? So a lot of people are going to be getting paid. You know, the school's going to be getting paid. ESPN's going to be getting paid. They're going to need new employees. So, by the way, if you guys are big on the ACC or whatever, they're going to need new employees to do a bunch of different things to run a television network, right? So, Dabo Swinney's now asked again. And, Jonathan Vilma was on the show. And so, they're asking about finally coming to a point where you pay players. You know what I mean? And I'm a person, full disclosure, that I don't think a salary system works. You know what I mean? It's just, I think it's too many moving parts. And maybe somebody smarter than me, like guys like John Solomon or a guy who I talk to often. I actually text back and forth with him a couple times today, a guy named Steve Silver, who is a sports attorney. His website is thelegalblitz.com. And I just text him like, hey, man, your boy's on TV talking stupid. Guys like that may be smarter than me to kind of come up with ways to, I don't know, salary players or stipend them. You know, there's a stipend system out now, but yeah, it's a drop in the bucket. You know, it got nothing to do with these TV deals and all this. There's money that's already there. So Dabo Swinney, his words were, I'm 100% against the professionalization of college football. Wait a minute. Hold up. Didn't you just sign a deal? You're a professional? So if that's the case, and, you know, the education is worth, because he started making that argument as well. You know, I was a walk-on. And so many times these students that leave Clemson, they leave with $100,000 in debt. Well, hold on, because that's a conversation that apparently they didn't have the time for on that show. But that's a governmental problem. The fact, the way these damn tuitions are skyrocketing, it's a part of the cutbacks that are always being made to education. The funding, the money, anyway, the money that goes to colleges from the government is shrinking and shrinking and shrinking. So they make up the difference by charging the students more and more and more. And to get more students, they start turning damn colleges into country clubs with fitness centers and hot tubs and all this kind of craziness. And it turns from like a place where you go to learn a school, and to kids picking a school because, you know, oh, they got the best university center and this, that, and the other. So those two things to me are mutually exclusive. The fact that some chemistry major is going to leave with $100,000 in debt, yeah, that problem, the government caused that problem. You know, they're passing on debt to future workers in this country and and citizens of this country who, in a lifetime, most of them will never pay it back. Like, yeah, see, these are the things that people want to stand on as, like, yeah, see, but our athletes don't leave with that. What they leave with? Brain injuries, bad backs, bad knees. Like me right now, personally, I played at the 1AA level. You see what I'm saying? Or what is it called now? The B, what is it called? Bowl championship? What, I don't know what the hell it's called. But anyway, the level under, like, where Florida State is. You know what I mean? So, and I still feel pain in my body. I don't think the chemistry student does. It's not from studying chemistry. You know what I mean? The time commitments and all. I talked about the time commitments and all that stuff yesterday. But this dude, man, like, then Jonathan Vilma says, but wait, even if you don't pay him, this is where I stand on it. Even if you don't pay him like a salary, some dude, Deshaun Watson, is his own entity at this point. The same way like Johnny Manziel was, the same way Christian McCaffrey is going to be this year, Leonard Fournette. These dudes are their own entities, and you'll sell their jerseys and ESPN will say, come see Deshaun Watson take on Dalvin Cook and the Florida State. You'll use their likenesses and their names and not give them a damn dime. This is America. Like, and then Jonathan Vilma points it out, like, where else in this country is that a thing? Where somebody gets to use me to make money, but I make none, and you pawn it off on, well, you're getting this fake-ass education. Nah. Nah, you could tell me you're selling me a car, but if it ain't got no damn engine in it, it ain't no good to me. At all. But that's the thing. Like, I was a walk-on, and I had to work my way. But here's the thing. As a walk-on, you make the choice. Because you're still paying for school. You're making a choice to do that extra stuff. I remember I had an accounting professor tell me, like, we was after our early morning workouts, you know, I'm sitting in class, like, all, like, sweaty, and because you got to rush to go eating and rush to go to class, and I'm sitting there, and I'm tired as hell, and I'm all, you know, I'm messed up. And so after class, I had to go to him for some help. He was like, I don't even know why we got a football program up here, because, you know, we weren't good or nothing. And I'm like, but wait a minute, if we didn't, I wouldn't be here. I wouldn't be at nobody college. You know what I mean? My mama ain't got no money for this. Out-of-state tuition on top of that? Nah. And that's the thing that he fails to realize. Like, a lot of those kids are there because that's the only way they're going to be in college anyway. And he proposed this real stupid thing. That's why I think we need a football minor leagues. Really? And you still think you'd get the same level of talent at your school? If there was a football minor leagues that a kid can just go from high school and play there and get ready and get paid and then go to the NFL, he'd go to college? Yeah, cut it in half immediately, and I'm being generous. Cut that joint in half now. And you still think you're pulling down $6, $7 million? Nah, man, he's just such an idiot. Such an idiot. You know, we've made huge strides in the value of the scholarship. I mean, look, we're even feeding the kids now. The dude actually said that. We're feeding them. Get your ass out of here, man. You're an idiot. You're an idiot, man. You're like a football savant. I mean, like, just coach football, dude, and shut up. And I very rarely say that, man, but like, there's no way to justify that, man. The indentured servitude of college football, it becomes more and more apparent each and every time another big money deal is struck. You know, Jonathan Vilma said it very, very eloquently. Ain't nobody coming to see you, coach. They coming to see Deshaun Watson. They coming to see them players. That's who packing them stadiums. Ain't nobody coming to see Nick Saban. Nah. They want to see Derrick Henry and them boys. Crazy, man. You know, again, this is my hypocrisy, man. I love college football. I love watching them dudes do their thing, man. But I hate the fact that, you know, that I don't see any way out of what they're doing, man. It's too big of a divide between the people. Like, those kids at Northwestern, a lot of those kids could afford to, not afford, like, financially, but, you know, there's not a lot of NFL players that play for Northwestern. So those kids could rise up together. You start doing that junk at like LSU, too many of those kids, whether they do or don't, believe that they will be in the National Football League. So then you have that divide. Just like when there are labor disputes in the pros. You got these cats that's making, you know, $100 million contracts, and you got the cats that's on the league minimum. The cats that's on the league minimum is like, no, whatever, man, get it done, sign it, get it done. The cast that's at the top is like, you know, we can wait. We can wait till we get what we want. And eventually the pressure of the lower class minority, the pressure of them, where they actually are the majority, the lower class majority, the pressure and the voices of them, they overshine or outshine the principles of the people sitting on top of the mountain. That's how those labor negotiations work. That's why the players in those situations, the labor, they never win, ever. You know what I mean? It's usually all for naught, and it's posturing and machismo and all that. Moving on here on the One Mic with Big Mike show, as we got a couple minutes left in the show. Don't forget, if you missed any portion of the show, check them out on Spreaker.com, the app for all your mobile devices, as well as on Blastify. You can also check them out on iTunes, TuneIn, iHeartRadio, YouTube, and my website, OneMicWithBigMike.com. And when I'm not here, you can still sound off. Send me your questions, your fantasy football questions, from my guy, Matt Latofsky from the Sporting News. He'll be on the show Wednesday, as well as R&B singer Tank. But you can send your questions for Matt to 678-568-9011. And what I'll do is I'll play them back for him to hear them, and hopefully it answers you and helps you win your fantasy football league. Speaking of fantasy football leagues, the One Mike with Big Mike Fantasy Football League is up and going. If you guys want to play fantasy football with me, send your email to me either via email, mike@onemicwithbigmike.com, or if you're listening right now, just click on that little thought bubble and drop it on in the live interactive chat room. Or if you're watching me, I forget this thing is on sometimes. If you're watching me on the live stream on YouTube. Oh, not YouTube. What is this called? Facebook Live. Facebook.com/ONEMICWITHBIGMIKE. You can drop it here in the comments. Yeah, you can comment with your email address if you want everybody to have it. Or you can inbox me. Yeah, that's a better way to do it. You can inbox me your email address, and I'll send you the invite to the Fantasy Football League. Now, moving on. Where do I want to go? I got a couple things here that I want to get to. Let's get to Chris Sales. The kid that pitches for the White Sox. Apparently, they wanted to wear throwback uniforms this weekend. He didn't want to wear them. They got, like, collars on them or whatever, and I think they made out of wool. It's hot as hell outside. Like, I'm with him. I'm with him all the way up until that. But then homeboy throws a temper tantrum, apparently, and goes through the locker room with a knife and starts slashing up people's, like, everybody else's uniform. So they couldn't, or the team couldn't wear him. They sent his ass home and subsequently suspended him for 5 days, which for a pitch, like, I don't understand how that works in baseball. It shouldn't work the same for pitchers. Because if you suspend your center fielder for 5 days, he's missing 5 days of work or five games. If you suspend a pitcher for 5 games, he's going to miss one start. That doesn't seem the way, that doesn't seem equal. Yeah, he should get suspended for 5 starts, but I guess, you know, with a guy like that, won 13 games, one of the better pitchers in the league, you can't miss him for 5 straight starts. Whatever, man. Like, baseball players are such petulant children. Don't stare at me. Don't flip your bat. Don't show me up. I'm going to get mad. I don't want to wear this uniform. Like, look, man, if you ain't want to wear the uniform, like, doctor your own joint. You know what I mean? Like, his point was valid, that the organization was more interested in selling uniforms than the players' comfort. All right, sweet. Point taken. Valid as it is. But you run around here chopping up everybody else's stuff, B. Like a child, like throwing a temper tantrum. Yeah, that ain't no good, man, at all. Also, over the weekend, I don't know how many of you guys pay attention to this. I didn't watch. I haven't seen a UFC fight live. I mean, like, on television. Like, one of the big events in a while, as a matter of fact. But not Ronda Rousey. Holly Holm, the chick who beat Ronda Rousey, gave Ronda Rousey her only loss, has now lost 2 straight fights. All right? Yeah, she's kind of getting Buster Douglas, man. Like, on some real stuff. Like, whoever is managing her career did a terrible job. Like, I remember seeing her, you know, post-Ronda Rousey fight interviews talking about, you know, how bad she wants to get back in the ring. She wants to go back into the ring, this, that, and the other. And I'm like, hold on, broad. Capture this, man. because I like that's the one thing about the UFC that I really like is the fact that like she didn't really just beat Ronda Rousey up like in like fight for fight. She hit her, and Ronda Rousey talked about it. Like the first punch she got on her, she knocked her out. Like she was out on her feet and couldn't regain her bearings at all. Like the fight was over from the first hit, and that's the one thing I like about it, that things can turn very quickly. So she didn't have to be necessarily a better fighter. She just had to be the person who struck first and best, and she did. But now she's had two consecutive fights that she's dropped, and she was in line at one point for like a couple of endorsements and like modeling stuff, and she was like, no, I want to concentrate on fighting, bruh. And now I'm reading today, I read her like scouting report, you know, the scouting report before the Ronda Rousey fight, and I think the name of the article was like Holly Holm is who we thought she was. And the people who cover the sport know more. Like, you know, got Layla Ali coming out later on. Like, yeah, man, I knew Holly Holm was going to do it. She's a good fighter. Not so much. She's a boxer that wanted to go into UFC, but was limited. She'd only fought a couple of fights before she fought Ronda Rousey. And the things I'm taking this from people who I assume know. The things that, you know, that's getting her ass whooped now are the things that people already knew were her limitations going in. Now, she's even, like, on some, like, way too brutally honest stuff. Like, her confidence is shook. Like, that's the last thing. Like, in a gladiator sport, like, that's the last thing. You done then. Like, you are definitely, you've been Buster Douglas, man. You knocked out Mike Tyson. And after that, sayonara, homeboy. Like, Buster Douglas got all fat and, yeah, it was over for him. Is he alive? I wonder. See, I'm so good for, like, killing people off, and I don't mean to. And lastly, the Olympics. Like, I so don't care about the Olympics. I think they should ban them. Not ban them. What's the word I'm using? I want to talk about banning, but I'll just end the whole thing. The Olympics is so stupid, man. And, you know, historically, it's really, like, homoerotic and weird. And at the end of the day, like, what actually gets accomplished? Hey, our people ran faster than your people. They swam faster than your people. What does that even mean? You know, in the grand scheme of things, what does it even mean? And I'm not saying that people shouldn't be able to run track and swim and compete. No, I'm not saying that at all. But, you know, come on. Like, the basketball is ridiculous. You know, we send Kevin Durant and Russell Westbrook and James Harden and the best of the best. And what's the kid's name? The kid that played for the Lakers with the long hair. Like, they playing against him. What the hell is that dude's name, man? I want to say Louis Scola, but that's not who I'm thinking about. Anyway, the Russians were supposed to, but people thought they were going to be banned, but the IOC decided they weren't going to ban all of them, and they were going to leave it up to the particular sports governing body. So 7 swimmers from Russia were banned for that doping thing they had going on, where they was like sneaking in and switching out the piss and all this kind of craziness. And they find it going all the way back to the Sochi Olympics. And I think before that, they were just cheating. And it's a sad state of affairs, especially I saw a chick on TV today who finished like 5th. And 2 of the girls who beat her got pinched for doping, man. And she, you know, she had an opportunity to realize her dream of meddling in the Olympics, man, and it didn't happen for her. She looked so heartbroken and so crestfallen, man. I was like, damn. You know, and there's no way to bring that. There's no way to get her that back. You know, you can give her the medal, but there's a lot of pageantry that goes on with that. And, like, the, you know, you're standing on the podium and everybody's cheering for you and all that. She can't get that back. I don't know. International sports is so crooked. And, like, we talk about this FIFA stuff all the time, but international sports in general is just so damn crooked. And, you know, it's all about, like, people putting these big stadiums and across the street from like some of the poorest people in the world. You know, you don't even have running water, but there's a new, you know, state-of-the-art stadium as they look out their back porch to dump out some, you know, human waste or something. It's just end it, man. Just I always say this when I talk about the Olympics, just look up, it's either white elephant or white whale. And basically all it is, man, these monstrosities, these big event venues, they just get left unused once the Olympics is gone. You know, they build them for the Olympics, and then once they're done, they're not used for anything at all. Like, luckily here in Atlanta, man, like the Olympic Village was used as dorms for Georgia State. Centennial Olympic Park still are on and popping. That tennis court out in Stone Mountain, you know, didn't fare so well, but you know, comparatively to other cities, you know, Atlanta came out very, very well after the Olympics. Anyway, it's the One Mic with Big Mike Show. Let me find my outro music here. It's the One Mic with Big Mike Show. I'm going to wrap things up for Monday. I appreciate everybody for joining me, everybody who participated in the show. My man, I Am No Doze, Matt, Renee, of course. Many, many thanks to Renee. Make sure you check me out on Wednesday. As my guest will be R&B singer Tank. He'll be talking about his role in the new edition. What is it called? Not a documentary. Is it a biopic? Anyway, the new edition movie. And sporting news fantasy football expert Matt Latovsky will also join me. Don't forget, follow me on Spreaker. Follow me on Twitter and Instagram at @MICWITHBIGMIKE. Like my Facebook page, One Mic with Big Mike. Spell out everything. ONEMICWITHBIGMIKE. Also, if you missed any portion of the show, make sure you check it out. You can do so via Spreaker, the app, BlastFi, TuneIn. You can go to iTunes, iHeartRadio, or my website, OneMicWithBigMike.com. And also, be sure to sound off. The sound off line is for y'all, man. Whatever you want to say, say it. If you want to ask questions to my guests on my fantasy football guest on Wednesday, do so via my sound off line at 678-568-9011. That's 678-568-9011. Leave me a message, about 30 seconds or less, and I'll play it back on Wednesday's show. Whatever you say. If it's a question for the fantasy guy, of course, I'll appropriate it there. If it's just a comment or a question, I'll play it as necessary. And if possible, keep them clean. You know, that's going to do it, man. You guys have a good one. I'll see you guys or talk to you guys on Hump Day.